Good evening, friends. We have a very interesting talk today on rheumatoid interstitial lung disease. We know that in immunology practice, rheumatoid arthritis is the most common connective tissue disease. In immunology OPD, most of the patients in the area, waiting area, who are suffering from this illness. This illness involves lungs in various ways. It can involve the airways, it can involve pleura and interstitial. Interstitial lung disease in rheumatoid arthritis can be UIP, NSIP, or it can be organizing pneumonia. Today we will be talking about rheumatoid interstitial lung disease. We would like to know from Dr. Hadda that if there is a case of rheumatoid arthritis, you do HRCT, find some interstitial lung disease or reticulations, whether you should treat this patient or you should wait. Whether these patients should be given immunomodulatory modifiers like azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, rituximab, tacrolimus, for how long to give, when to give, and what is the role of nintedanib. Dr. Vijay Hadda is an additional professor in the Department of Pulmonary Critical Care and Sleep Medicine at All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Dr. Hadda, please.
Surgeons, gastroenterologists in this form. It is little surprise for me. I kept my talk in a way that I can tell something to physicians, but I'm pretty sure there will be in corporate sometimes it will be very difficult to say patient no. There will be orthopedician who is treating PUO, there may be a gastroenterologist who is treating tuberculosis of lung, so on and so forth. So I hope that everybody will gain something or other from this. So coming to my talk, what I will do is, I will present a case, and then maybe from that case, we will try to answer all the questions which were taught by Dr. P.K. Mangla that when to treat a patient with ILD in rheumatoid arthritis, what to treat, how to treat like that. So, this is a 45-year-old gentleman who came to us, and he was symptomatic for last 2 years with cough and shortness of breath, and it was progressively increasing. So this is a typical kind of scenario in our OPD or maybe the physicians. So based on these symptoms, the physician examined him and then subsequently ordered some tests, and this is usual that we will ask for a chest x-ray and depending on other findings, CT, chest. So this was the chest x-ray. If you see, there is lots of reticulate shadows predominantly on the lower joints, both sides, and there are some reticulations in upper lungs also, maybe mid zone and upper zone also. So this is a typical x-ray of a patient who is having underlying ILD. But only on X-ray we cannot make a diagnosis of ILD. ILD diagnosis always made on a CT scan. That also a good quality CT scan, which is nowadays classified high resolution CT scan, HRCT. And that also there is lots of specification that how to obtain a CT scan. I think I will not divulge on that more. But there is a protocol for CT scan for ILDs also, which are having some volumetric kind of a acquirement and expiratory prone position like that, depending on patient. So if we see this CT scan, this CT scan shows there are multiple cystic lucencies which are there, and they are in multiple layers. Then there are some bronchiectasis, traction bronchiectasis, which are bilateral, and more if you see this CT scan, they are more at basis. So if any physician will see this CT scan, the diagnostic pattern is very easy and it will be labeled as usual interstitial pneumonitis pattern or UIP pattern. And once we see this, most of the time we make a diagnosis of IPF, and in this case it's more so because it's a male patient, smoker, and CT is showing UIP pattern. So it's very easy to make a diagnosis of UIP, and then UIP in most of the time we take it as IPF unless we use our more knowledge of ILDs which is required for a final diagnosis. So as usual, this patient labeled as IPF and he was started on antifibrotic drugs. So we don't know whether this was the right decision, wrong decision, or it depends on situation. So this was the background. So whenever we come across any patient with ILD, there are 2-3 steps which are required to achieve a diagnosis. First and foremost thing is we need to rule out mimics, because these kind of shadows on X-ray as well as CT scan can be seen in diseases other than ILDs also. If some cardiologist is sitting here, then he might recollect that a patient who is having chronic congestive heart failure, they can also have a similar reticular kind of shadows. So in that case, the underlying disease, history, clinical presentation will help us whether this is ILD or other. Similarly, sometimes infection can present in a similar way, especially if it is a organized pneumonia pattern or NICU pattern. That can be seen in infections also. So that is the first step, that we rule out mimics. Then second part will be, because ILD as such is not a single disease, it's a group of disorders, which has almost 200 type of diseases. So few are idiopathic, few are having underlying causes. And whenever I say idiopathic, so sometime back I heard a joke. Idiopathic means idiot doctor and pathetic patient. So that is true. Unless we use our full knowledge, we should not label anything idiopathic. Idiopathic means either we don't know or patient is probably not helping us. So idiopathic we only label when we have used all our knowledge for workup, and despite that full workup we are unable to find any cause. Then once we have ruled out all secondary causes, it may be drugs, it may be exposure, it may be some connective tissue disease, and the list is huge. So once we rule out that, then only we label that this patient has idiopathic ILDs, and then final diagnosis, whether it is idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis or idiopathic NSIP, or it is connective tissue disease related ILD, or it is hypertensive pneumonitis. Based on that, we label a final diagnosis. So, as I told, this ILD is a heterogeneous disease. So, to make a diagnosis, we always require a comprehensive kind of evaluation. This evaluation will include the clinical evaluation, which includes detailed history as well as examination. It will require some assessment in the form of pulmonary function testing, which include the volume, flow, and diffusion capacity. It will require chest imaging, especially a good quality CT scan. And in few cases only, we will require biopsy, where we are unable to make any diagnosis and our all these investigations are not helping. Once we have all these information, then also we will require an integration of this information with the help of multidisciplinary team. This multidisciplinary team usually consists of at least pulmonologist, radiologist, and if you will add a rheumatologist, that will be a great help, because at least pulmonologists are not good rheumatologists. This is my impression. Although I am from medicine background, so I have little bit of knowledge regarding immunology also. But with my experience with my residents, those who are coming from pulmonology background, their immunology is not so good. So including rheumatologists can be very, very helpful. Even in best of physicians, we may miss the subtle signs which are there to make a diagnosis of any rheumatological disorder. Then, if lung biopsy is there, then definitely pathologists will also be required in this team. So, as I told, multidisciplinary team discussion after that is the gold standard of diagnosis, and currently that is recommended one. So, if we see ILD answers, they are idiopathic one, these are as I told, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, idiopathic NSIP, DIP, cryptogenic organic pneumonia, the list is again long. Then there are secondary causes. Among secondary causes, if you see, there are multiple studies. There are at least two good studies published from India and in our network also. If I see that connective tissue disease is among top three causes of ILDs, then I am not wrong. In many situations, it may be number two also, depending on where you are practicing. In some centers, the rheumatologist is the primary running physician who is running the ILD clinic. And in some hospitals, the rheumatology department is different. For example, ours, the rheumatology is different, so there may be less patients with connective tissue disease who are following with us as compared to the hospital where rheumatologist is not separate. So that being one reason, but overall it suggests it can be number two or number three among causes of ILDs. So if I discuss that how much evaluation in the form of clinical history is required, then definitely we need to assess the occupational history, exposure history. Exposure many times can be missed unless we take a detailed history. In our OPD, many times resident will come that this patient is working as a clerk for last 10 years, but he will not take other histories. For example, he may be interested in gardening, there may be so much exposure. Similarly, the farmers, they can have pets at home, or they may be storing hay, so they can be exposed to that also. Even sometimes we say that the lady will come, they will say we are homemakers, but still they are exposed to many things. Again, I'm telling, they may be hearing kettles, so again, hay exposure may be there. So unless we take a detailed exposure history, we will miss many patients who are having underlying hypersensitive pneumonitis. So exposure history is very, very important. Sometime back I came across a patient who was engineer by profession. So everybody was telling he is engineer, but then we dig little bit deep, he was chemical engineer.
Very good.
And then we found out that this ILD, whatever is there, likely because of occupational exposure instead of some kind of idiopathic one. So detailed exposure history is very, very important. Then connective tissue disease. This is the one thing which is commonly missed. If I say that when there is a gross kind of findings, it is very easy to pick from anyone. But when there are subtle findings, in those cases, I think rheumatologist friends are very, very useful. We should take their help and we should not hesitate to refer a patient for their opinion. So, because today we are focusing more on connective tissue disease, RILD, so this history, I again want to emphasize that whenever there is doubt, whenever you are making a diagnosis of idiopathic one, I will suggest please first consult a rheumatologist so that we don't miss any subtle kind of clinical features, maybe some plus minus autoimmune features in the form of positive serology, which we may not know what is the value of that, or maybe some kind of certain nail changes, skin changes. So they can be very, very helpful. Sometimes we do a capillaroscopy, which is not available usually with pulmonologists. Rheumatologists can do easily, and they can easily pick up telangiectasias. So that can be very, very helpful. So I would suggest, before making any ILD idiopathic, rheumatologist opinion is must. As a physician, we can take a history of CTDs. I have not segregated based on diseases, but if we ask these features, then probably in more than 99 cases we will be able to pick, if we can ask regarding joint pain, swelling, morning stiffness. Similarly, oral ulcer, skin rash, photosensitivity, hair loss, Raynaud's phenomena, skin thickening, digital ulcer, or dry eye, dry mouth, muscle weakness, constitutive symptoms. If any of these are there, then that can be red flag that this patient is not having any kind of idiopathic disease. There definitely there is going to be some secondary cause, especially some kind of connective tissue disease. So then once we have finished the history, then we should focus on clinical examination. These pictures I have shown because they are gross. And these kind of patients, if anybody come across, and I am pretty sure nobody will miss. But if these are there, then we should also think of that underlying lung disease is related to the primary illness. These pictures are typically from a patient who is having scleroderma or systemic sclerosis. They are typical findings which are shown. They are related to skin, the restrict mouth opening, then there are skin changes, digital ulceration, the Raynaud's phenomenon, bleeding of digital dysphonia, then calcinosis. If these are there, then easily we can make a diagnosis that this patient is having scleroderma. Similarly, his oral ulcers, this malar rash, alopecia, and some joint swelling is there. Then typically we can make the diagnosis that likely we are facing or this patient might be an underlying SLE. Similarly, sarcoidosis, this kind of skin rash, the scleritis or skin rash here. So if these are there, then again we can easily make a diagnosis that likely this patient is having sarcoidosis. Similarly, this patient has joint deformities. These are easy to pick, but many times this patient will have subtle kind of swelling. Unless we press it, then we cannot elicit that there is a tenderness. So we need a intelligent kind of examination. Then sometimes, other than joints, you can find these kind of nodules. So if these are there, then again we can make a diagnosis of that there is some kind of connective tissue disease here underlying. And if we are not sure what kind of connective tissue disease, at least we can make a diagnosis that this underlying cause of ILD is connective tissue disease. It may be rheumatoid, it may be anything else. Similarly, another is parotid enlargement, the lacrimal gland enlargement, dry tongue, dry eyes. These are common symptoms seen in geograms. Similarly, there can be rough hands. So these are important when somebody says that I am an office worker and still their hands are rough, cracked, there are lots of fissuring. So if that patient is having underlying the connective tissue disease, then we start thinking this sign is called a mechanic's hand. So if that is there, then we should again start thinking that these hands and lung may have some relationship, and these are common finding in patients who are having inflammatory myositis. Maybe dermatomyositis, polymyositis, and then we can also demonstrate some weakness, proximal muscle weakness if patient is having some difficulty in getting up. And these kind of skin rashes we can see easily in vasculitis. So any patient we are facing with ILD, that patient requires a detailed, intelligent, focused kind of examination. And if I say skin, joints and eyes are very, very important for helping in diagnosis of ILD, for helping in making a diagnosis of connective tissue disease. So our case, I'm coming back to that, when we asked him, so he had joint pain as well as swelling, and these joints were small joints of hand, wrist, and bilateral ankle joints were there. So he on examination also, we could demonstrate that there was active synovitis, and we pressed the joints, so we can demonstrate that there was active synovitis. That patient did not have any skin rash, nodes, eye symptoms, or dryness, reflux, dysphagia, or any other symptoms which can point toward other associated connective tissue disease. Also, there was no history of exposure to pets, pigeons, birds at home. These are very important. If these are there, then they can indicate toward hypersensitive pneumonitis. Also, he had no constitutive symptoms. These kind of symptoms sometimes can also be there in subacute or acute kind of hypersensitive pneumonitis, or sometimes in connective tissue diseases. He was not taking any drugs, and he was having a test job, so there was no significant exposure also, other exposure. So clinically we made a diagnosis of inflammatory polyarthritis. So if as a physician or pharmacist we can make a diagnosis that patient is having inflammatory polyarthritis, I think our job is done. At least we will not label that patient as idiopathic ILD. The subsequent classification, if you know, that's good. If no, then we can take help from our rheumatologist colleagues. So this case highlights that history as well as examination, especially extrapulmonary examination. Because if you examine lungs, then findings will be not helping. At the most, you will find crackles, which are non-specific, which will be seen in almost all the ILDs. In some time, we can find some skews, which can indicate maybe HP. Otherwise, most of the time, these findings don't help. So extrapulmonary finding, we should be more focusing when we are making a diagnosis of ILD. Then next comes the laboratory investigations. So there are few investigations which are routine, which will be we are doing not for diagnosis but helping, maybe in deciding therapies or maybe having some assessment of underlying other organ involvement, or maybe during follow-up we will need this test to see if there is any toxicity of drugs or not. And then in all patients of ILD, as a routine, we ask for rheumatoid factor, ANA and anti-CCP. These are kind of mandatory. Almost all the guidelines, including Indian guidelines, recommend that this minimum serology should be done in every patient. And if anything positive or there are some indicator, then subsequently we will ask for other tests. Then screening for comorbidities. These are important because all the drugs which we use to treatment for these cardiac tissue disease related ILD or ILD-X, they will have impact on management of comorbidities. For example, if you want to give corticosteroids, that will increase the blood sugar, or maybe it will increase the blood pressure also. So comorbidity screening is also very important. So if you want extended kind of autoimmune profile, so this list is increasing every day. So those who are extensively involved in ILD practice, they should know that how many antibodies are available there, how much we can do and how much are available, how much cost. And many times cost may be prohibitive, but before labeling, I will again say we should do a detailed kind of examination. At our center, we will ask for RF, ANA, then NTCCP and ELA. If these are at least we do before saying that this patient is having idiopathic ILD. So this is another list. If you see, this list is increasing. Then also, sometimes we do hypersensitivity panel also. If suppose all this workup is negative and there are some finding on CT that it can be HP or maybe no finding also, still we do HP panel also before labeling the patient idiopathic ILD. PFT evaluation again, it will not help to make a diagnosis of with any ILD, but it will be helpful to classify the severity of the disease. So that is very helpful. We do spirometry, we do DLCO, and we do 6-minute walk test. So all these tests are required in decision making or taking decision. And also this baseline value will help in the monitoring of patient when we are following this patient, whether this patient is improving, deteriorating or stable disease. Other tests we will do for this patient if we discuss. These were the reports which I have not shown many, but these tests were normal and the rheumatoid factor was 256, very high. Similarly, NTCCP was also very high. More than 90 is considered very high. And I think up to 20 is the cutoff, below which we see is negative. So this was positive. ANA, ENA profile, it was not done because these were positive and there was classical rheumatoid arthritis feature, so we did not ask for that. Hypersensitivity also, we did not ask because setting was not fitting into that and already we established a diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis, so we did not ask for that also. Spirometry we did. The if you see FVC, it was 53%, FEV1 57%, and similar DLCO was 25%. 6-minute walk test also. So these tests show that there was significant lung parenchyma involvement, there was significant physiological impairment. If these kind of patients are there, definitely this patient will require some treatment. It cannot be left like we will observe this patient and after some time we will again see whether this patient is deteriorating or is stable. Then few things regarding bowel, because many times we keep on asking full when you are suspecting an infection or malignancy. So alternative diagnosis you can rule out with this. In few cases, for example suspected HP, so if we do bowel, that can be helpful. If there is a lymphocytosis, if there, that can make our plus minus diagnosis a little bit more confident. For example, a patient is having plus minus history of exposure and CT is showing some findings which are suggestive or indicating toward HP, and then we do the bowel and that is showing a lymphocytosis more than 25%, then our confidence of diagnosis or confidence in the diagnosis of HP will be more as compared to without bowel. So in that case it can helpful. Other thing, in other diseases probably it will not very helpful. Few rare diseases it can be diagnostic also, but most of the time bowel is used to rule out other etiologies as compared to making a diagnosis. Then comes the biopsy. So if I say every patient of ILD do not require biopsy, if I say majority of patients do not require biopsy, both statements are correct. Only there will be few patients where you have used everything, you have conducted a multidisciplinary discussion. Despite that, if you are unable to make any diagnosis, in those cases only you can consider. There also it is not recommended. So if CT is suggestive, because biopsy will only give you the pathological pattern. And if you ask me, in pathological pattern, UIP, if CT is showing UIP, then there are very, very high chances histopath will also show the same thing. So it will not add anything. but in known UIP pattern, and if you are unable to make any diagnosis, this lung biopsy can be helpful in making pattern, as well as it can give some indication toward diagnosis also. For example, if this patient, we are unable to make a diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis and we go ahead with biopsy, we could have seen some kind of lymphoid aggregates, which can indicate that it is rheumatoid, or it may be connective tissue disease related IRD, or there may be lymphocytic infiltration. So there may be some telltale signs which can help in making diagnosis, whether it is idiopathic, or it may be hypersensitivity pneumonitis, or it may be related to some connective tissue disease. So that is only done when MDD is not helpful.
Very good.
So as I told, if we do biopsy, so conventional TBLED is not very helpful. It is very good for sarcoidosis. In other ILDs will be not helpful. Then other things which as a pulmonologist I can do is cryo-TBLB. Using through bronchoscope I can do cryobiopsy. That is a relatively new technique of this getting biopsy. With that we can also achieve a yield maybe around 70 to 75%. It can be helpful in obtaining a pathological pattern on biopsy. Otherwise surgical biopsy, maybe wets or open, is the gold standard. However, if you ask me how many patients are fit for this, I think only 10 to 20% will be fit, because of maybe our tertiary care center. So all patients we are dealing with, they are mostly advanced disease. Most of the patients will be having maybe associated pulmonary hypertension, or they are already on oxygen supplements. So that is the absolute contraindication for lung biopsy. So we are unable to do open lung biopsy in almost any patient. So this I put because our patient is having rheumatoid arthritis. So these are the criteria which are suggested by EULA, and they were updated in 2010. So if anybody is fulfilling these criteria, so there will be joint involvement, and based on number of joints we score this, then based on serology we score, and then symptom duration, and then few inflammatory markers. Based on this score, and the score is more than 6, then we can confidently classify that patient is having rheumatoid arthritis. But things are not so simple in clinical practice. There may be patient who will be having some indicator, maybe some patient is having I have joint pain only, but you are not finding other things. The serology will be negative, or maybe the joint count is only single joint or two joints are involved. So we may not be confident. And if you ask Dr. Mangla, he will agree with me that there are number of patients where we are unable to put those patients in a definite category of any kind of connective tissue disease. So till few years back, I think 2 or 3 years back, these patients were classified like everybody was putting their own term, lung dominant CTD or undifferentiated CTD, unclassified CTD, they were labeling like that. But I think 2 or 3 years back, I think two years back, people have suggested a definite term for this also. They have classified this patient as interstitial pneumonia with autoimmune feature. So now it is suggested that everybody should use this term instead of this undifferentiated connective tissue disease or lung dominant connective tissue disease. So instead of that, this is the suggested term which should be used for those patients where there are some feature of autoimmunity, but we are unable to make any diagnosis. So they suggested that, if I think I can go back. So they have suggested these criteria to classify this, that there will be ILD on the CT scan, and we have excluded other causes, as I told, we have excluded hypersensitivity pneumonitis, we have excluded the full-fledged kind of connective tissue disease, they should not be there, and then we see that this patient is fulfilling one of those criteria, clinical domain, serological domain, morphological domain, and based on this, we classify that. So these are the various criteria in clinical, these are fissuring, ulceration, inflammatory arthritis, telangiectasia, renal phenomena, digital edema, and like that. Similarly, morphological feature, if NSIP, OP, NSIP, OP pattern on this LIP pattern, if these are there on this one, and then this is serology. If these are there, then we can label this patient as IPF or interstitial pneumonitis with autoimmune features. So I think those who are pulmonologists or physicians who are practicing ILD, they should remember this, and instead of using other term, we should use IPF 4 interstitial pneumonitis with autoimmune features as a diagnosis of these kind of patients. So, as I told, this is not an uncommon scenario, and as I told, all these entities have been clubbed like IPF, and these patients need close follow-up because it may be like this is just onset of the disease, and maybe over the period there will be full flash or full clinical, clearly apparent kind of feature of underlying CKD. And so that's why these patients, once we have classified, they need a close follow-up over the period.
Very good.
Our case, they is having distal joint pain, swelling, active synovitis which involved wrist, this MCP joint, PIP, ankle. So this is classical presentation of rheumatoid. RFNTC is positive. Rheumatologist evaluation was also done, which they did X-ray, and that showed erosive arthritis. HRCT, as I told, this is UIP pattern, so this was not required. So finally, he was labeled as RA-associated UIP pattern, RA-associated. So if we face any patient with rheumatoid arthritis, so there will be three clinical scenarios. One is like this patient who was not diagnosed. Patient came up to you or came to me with ILD, and I want to know whether this patient is having underlying any CKD or cranial tissue disease or not. The second thing is, patient may be having underlying already known this connective tissue disease or maybe rheumatoid arthritis. In that case, our duty as a pulmonologist is whether this underlying ILD is there or not. In those cases, our duty is that. And when the patient is having rheumatoid arthritis and he has already been diagnosed ILD, in those cases, we need to answer when and how to treat those patients. So in coming slides, we will try to answer these two or three questions. So first question we have already answered, there is a new patient who is not having any kind of rheumatoid arthritis feature, and then we made a diagnosis. The second question is, patient is having rheumatoid arthritis. So whether that patient is having ILD or not, how to come to know? So there can be few clinical features. So if any patient who is male with rheumatoid arthritis, there is more likely chance that he may be having underlying ILD. Similarly, those patients who are having extra articular manifestation, those patients are also having a excessive risk of development of ILD. And most of the time, as I told, the joint symptom will precede. However, there are many studies which have shown that about 10 to 50% patient, lung may be the first site where this rheumatoid is showing effect, and maybe later on the articular manifestation will be there. Also, the patient will have a severe joint disease. For example, in our case, the joint count was more than 10. There will be extra articular disease also, for example, subclavian nodule. So if somebody is having that, there are more chances of that. Cigarette smoking is very strongly associated with rheumatoid arthritis as well as rheumatoid associated ILD, because smoking itself leads to citrullination. So this citrullination, arginine to citrulline conversion, is the central pathogenesis of rheumatoid arthritis. And if citrullination occurs, that is the pathological factor which may be associated with rheumatoid as well as rheumatoid associated ILD. So if somebody is not smoking, we should strongly ask that patient not to start smoking. If somebody is smoking, we should strongly suggest that they should quit. Even because if they keep on smoking, then there are high chances that they will develop ILD in rheumatoid arthritis. Similarly, if somebody is having very high level of rheumatoid factor or anti-CCP, they are also more likely to have development of ILD. Diagnosis again, as I told, RA with ILD, there are high chances this will be related to RA itself. But we should not forget that there are many drugs which can also lead to lung toxicity, for example, methotrexate. Although those who are reading recent publications, they can argue with me that the recent trials are not showing so much of lung toxicity with methotrexate. But still we know that methotrexate can be a lung toxic drug, so we should remember that. Similarly, rheumatoid itself do not prevent development of hypersensitive pneumonitis. So we should also keep that also in mind. Or maybe some other drugs also which can lead to ILD. So again, whenever we see ILD and in any disease, we will again need a multidisciplinary team for discussion, which may include radiologist, rheumatologist, pulmonologist, pathologist. And based on intelligent, in-depth discussion, we will reach a conclusion whether this is looking like a rheumatoid lung or it is something else, maybe drug positivity, maybe infection, or maybe hypertension pneumonitis. So, as I told, we need to evaluate patient for hypertension pneumonitis, maybe pneumoconiosis, or sometimes there may be some other CDD also. CDD can, there will be overlap also. There are many patients who will be having the rheumatoid arthritis with Sjogren, maybe SLE, sometimes they will be having inflammatory myositis also. So, MDD also helps in that also, that patient is having other connective diseases also. So, this slide I have summarized various manifestations which can be seen in a patient with rheumatoid arthritis if we do CT scan. So, there may be lung panicumal changes which are typically classified as ILD. So, there may be UIP pattern, NIC pattern, organ pneumonia, LIP, DIP. But UIP is the most common pattern in rheumatoid arthritis as compared to other ILDs, where NSIP is far more common than UIP pattern. Similarly, if you see ARDs, these kind of complications you can see on CT scan, maybe bronchiectasis, maybe bronchiolitis, small airway disease, or maybe pleural effusion. And maybe there may be few senior physicians who are sitting here. If they go maybe 20-30 years back when CT was not so easily available, they will say pleural disease was the most common extra-articular manifestation because CT was known that at that point of time, and X-ray was a good modality to pick up pleural effusion. So sometime back, this was considered as the most common manifestation of extra-articular manifestation of rheumatoid. So this is the diagram which I tried to summarize everything. Once a patient with a CT scan showing ILD pattern, so there will be two scenarios. There may be existing eye, or there may be unknown disease. So in those cases where this, we don't know what is happening, we need to evaluate the patient for all the other causes including connective tissue disease. And if any feature of connective tissue disease is there, we need a rheumatology consultation. With rheumatology consultation, they may say that there is no chance this patient will have any connective tissue disease, ultimate diagnosis is made. If they are saying there is definite CTD, then patient will come here. And then we start what kind of pattern is there, because this pattern, based on this pattern, we will decide the therapy. So this can be UIP, NSIP, OP, or LIP pattern. So this is the rheumatoid typical ILD. There can be airway involvement, small airway or large airway. The small airway will be presenting like nosocomialization, central lobar nodule, bronchial lobar thickening. Or there may be some alternate diagnosis. For example, CT can show that there is a big patch, maybe pneumonia, so there may be infection. So this is the flow diagram how we assess a patient who has undergone CT scan. And this is the flow diagram which is showing once patient is having rheumatoid arthritis and there is a worsening of symptoms. And especially if there is a fever, then again this CT scan will show some new panchayatal abnormalities, and based on those abnormalities, maybe nodule, GGOs, once we have defined this, then we will go ahead, maybe BAL, if, because sudden worsening infection is very high on the list as a differential diagnosis. In those patients, we will require BAL, and we will do all these tests where depending on the scenario, and based on that, we will make a diagnosis whether this is a drug-induced ILD, whether it is an infection, or it is just progression of the disease. So based on this, we will take a call. So once we have done this one, then we will discuss few principles when we are treating these patients. So most important thing is we have to have the baseline assessment of the patient. So this is very common that patient is following with the rheumatologist or physicians, but no one is getting spirometry or HRCT of the patient. So once patient is coming maybe after 5 years down the line, and that time patient is having some respiratory symptoms, we will not be able to tell how much is the progression at that point of time. So those physicians who are attending here, my take home message is, please, any patient, if they are following rheumatoid arthritis, please assess for lung involvement with the help of spirometry, DLCO, and if you can do a chest imaging, especially HRCT scan, that can be very, very helpful later when you are following that patient and you develop some lung complications. Then based on the severity, age, comorbidities and pattern, and also patient wishes. I am stressing on this patient wishes because all the treatment, you name any drug, this drug at the best, they are having only moderate efficacy. They are not going to change the maybe dramatic, there will be no dramatic changes. It will not like somebody is having a FVC of 50% and suddenly it will jump to 70% or 80%. If at the best, you are expecting some stabilization or only little bit of improvement. So if somebody is very old, they may say, I will not take any treatment because even if it progresses, it will progress very slowly. And that's why patient visit is also very important. Although in our practice, most of the time, we don't take too much consideration regarding this patient visits. So these are the principles which apply to every patient with an ILD. So each patient, we need to evaluate whether this patient is requires some oxygen supplementation or not. Patient education is very important regarding the underlying disease, how the disease may behave, what complications they can develop, when to report to the physician, and if some emergency, how to tackle that. Pulmonary rehabilitation is one which is very underutilized, and reason may be many, because many centers don't even have the facility of pulmonary rehabilitation. It is very, very costly affair and not very revenue generating if I take consideration of corporate hospitals. So that may be one reason why pulmonary rehabilitation is not very commonly used. But believe me, if you want to use, it's very, very fruitful. Once patient completed first 2 or 3 weeks, when they come back, their face is totally different. You can see the smile over the face. Then vaccinations. All the patients who are having underlying lung disease, they will require pneumococcal vaccine, flu shot every year, pneumococcal vaccine at least once, and maybe repeat vaccination may require after 5 years. And then symptomatic treatment. Sometimes patient, you have exhausted all the treatment, but patient will keep on coughing. So irrespective of advanced disease or initial disease, we need to take care of symptoms. Lung transplant, we will discuss later, maybe one slide. So once we have seen a patient of this rheumatoid ILD, we need to tell whether this patient will be benefited with specific treatment or not. So that will depend that how severe is the underlying disease. For example, somebody is coming for the first time to me, then based on some test, HRCT and spirometry impairment, I will make up my mind how much is the involvement, how much is the impairment. That is important to take a call whether this patient will be benefited with treatment or not, or just I can take some time to observe that how patient is behaving. Then next thing is, if you have follow-up patient and you have some investigation prior, then you can see the rate of progression. If somebody is worsening in the form of increased symptoms, decline spirometry, for radiological deterioration, then again we need to take a call whether patient will be beneficial treatment or not. Similarly, pattern of the abnormality. Some diseases, they are very responsive to treatment. For example, organ pneumonia. If you treat, they show very quick response. So, whom to treat? So, based on all these things, we need to take a call which group of patients are likely to respond to therapy. And also, we need to weigh the risk and benefit, whether this benefits are more or risk of infection especially. If you think that in given patient, risk of infection is more as compared to benefit, in those cases also, we may think whether this treating this patient is going to be helpful or not. So, I found this table which is very interesting. Irrespective of any kind of underlying cause, we can see before starting treatment. So all the ILDs can be classified like this. So there may be some ILDs where there will be potential of reversibility with risk of irreversible disease. Meaning thereby, if you will treat that, there are chances it may be reversed. And if you not treat, there are chances it will progress. For example, drug-related ILDs, especially if I talk about rheumatoid arthritis. The patient may be on methotrexate and they develop this lung toxicity. So unless you will stop that drug, there are chances it will keep on progressing. And if you stop, there are high chances it will recover. So this kind of scenario are very important. Another scenario is reversible disease, the risk of progression. For example, cellular NSAP, some fibrotic NSAP and OP. OP I told, and cellular NSAP and OP. There are very high chances if you treat, there are very high chances of reversibility. So this, if there is CT showing this kind of pattern, again you will take a call to treat instead of waiting. if there are patient who are stable and residual disease, for example, fibrotic NSIP, many patients of fibrotic NSIP, and some patient of this, UIP is usually progressive, but some can be stabilized also. In this group of patients, we may just observe, take time, see the response, and then only we can take a call whether treating this patient or exposing this patient to toxic drugs is going to make some difference or not. Similarly, there may be situations where progressive irreversible disease with potential to for stabilization. So if you see UIP, fibrotic NSIP, they are usually progressive. So if you will not halt the progression, there are chances that they will keep on progressing. So we should put some effort to halt that progression. So here again we should consider treatment. Progressive irreversible disease, for example, DAD, this is usually an acute exacerbation of ILD, most UIP, they come into this category. So I think I am about to finish, sir. 5 minutes probably. So once patient is having mild disease, for example, mild dyspnea and the spirometry is preserved, decreasing capacity is preserved, we don't treat those patients and we keep those patients under follow-up, maybe 3 to 6 monthly with spirometry and DLCO, and based on that we take a call. CT scan is usually not required, that is done only once patient is having new symptoms. Once patient has severe or progressive disease, then only they will be requiring treatment, and primary stay of treatment is inflammatory or immunosuppressive disease. One message I want to give is, even if you have a pattern, first time you are facing, antifibrotics alone are not the first line drug. Any patient with chronic inflammatory disease, even if you want to give antifibrotic, always combine with immunosuppressive. First, those patients should get a trial of immunosuppressive agents before giving antifibrotic. At the best, you can combine, but never antifibrotic alone. So these are the various drugs which are available: MMF, azathioprine, rituximab, corticosteroid, cyclophosphamide, same scenario. And if you ask me which drug is better, almost every drug is same. And this, I am not saying this experience from various centers. This was one study which has shown that you use any of these, all are having equal efficacy. Only thing is, azathioprine is considered inferior because in that study there was more chances of dropout in this group because of various side effects. Corticosteroids. So there are two guidelines which suggest that this drug, I never used. Rituximab we commonly use. So these are the two drugs which can be probably rheumatologists use these drugs a lot. But if you ask me, we have some experience with rituximab. So you can use rituximab. So corticosteroids, if I talk, they are very useful in OP pattern, rapidly progressive or acute exacerbation. Whenever there is, we can give corticosteroids. And this is a table, there are shown various doses which can be used for these drugs. One thing I want to tell is, MMF is very good drug, however, most of the time we don't use the full doses of this drug. Many patients will be just using 500 mg twice daily. But for a good response, at least 2 gram per day is required, maybe 3 gram per day. The other thing is corticosteroid. We should use corticosteroid in very low dose whenever we are combining with any immunosuppressives. So recently we published a paper regarding rituximab, and we showed that if you use rituximab, it can be useful option. It can stabilize drug, stabilizes ILD in many patients who are having underlying rheumatoid arthritis. So this is a very good option. So less commonly used drugs are these. So I think I have almost exhausted my time. Acute familial disease, there is no protocol, but these are drugs which can be used. Worsening non-fibrotic, again, we can change drugs, so we can switch from one to other, we can start new drug. Worsening fibrotic, here comes the antifibrotic role. So these are the various criteria we can use this if you want to use nintedanib. And because there is no guideline for rheumatoid lung, but same criteria which were used in ill-built trial, we can use when we are deciding antifibrotic in rheumatoid ILD also. So, because in built trial there are many fibrotic ILDs other than IPR, and among those there are few patients, I think 30 or 40 patients were having rheumatoid ILD which were non-IPR. So in those cases they saw that there is stabilization of the disease, and these were the benefits. If you see the difference of almost 100 ml FVC at 1 year. So this is again a useful moderate fibrotic or progressing kind of disease.
Very good.
So other thing, we don't know whether this combining the drugs with antifibrotic is the stimulus pressing, what is the benefit or risk, we don't know. So to conclude, gentlemen, this ILD is very common lung manifestation of all the CTDs including rheumatoid arthritis. It can present many times, at least in 10-15% cases it can present without joint involvement. Therefore, the diagnosis requires multidisciplinary team discussion. So that is very, very important, and that is considered as a core standard to make diagnosis of any kind of ILD. Treatment protocols are not standardized because there is not enough studies. If you ask me any RCT, there is none. There is no RCT till now to show that this treatment is better than others. But few general kind of principles are like mild disease can be observed. You can follow the patient 3 to 6 monthly, and if there is progression, you can start the treatment. Immunosuppressive remains the first line of drug. Antifibrotic should not be used as an initial therapy. I am stressing only initial therapy. I am not saying it should not be used, but as an initial therapy, especially standalone, it should not be used. The general treatment for is similar as the advice for other lung diseases. Lung transplant can be done, and if somebody is fulfilling all the criteria, the success we can expect as good as other indications. Thank you, gentlemen. Is there any question or comment? I will move to this about.
Yes,
good evening, friends. Please, 15 minutes to 20 minutes to Dr. P.K. Bandar, please. Before I start the talk, I am thankful to Dr. Sachin Chahal and Physician Forum of India to give me this opportunity to speak in front of all of you. You see, I would like to mention that about more than a decade ago, I was asked to see a patient in one of the nursing homes in South Delhi. This was a young gentleman, about 25 years of age, and he was admitted with high grade fever. And in spite of receiving high-end antibiotics, his fever was not settling. It was 103, 104, and his chest X-ray revealed an extensive pneumonia. So the treating physician was in a fix that what to do. Every day money was spent. When I asked the history, he gave me that he was an engineer from Kanpur, and he was admitted in BITS Pilani in computer engineering course. And there this gentleman developed loose motions, and he was blaming the mess of the of his college, to the extent that diarrhea troubled him so much that he left the course and went back to Kanpur and did his engineering from some college in Lucknow. When he went to Kanpur back, he started developing some boils. One boil will get better and the other one will disappear, and the new one will come. It was really terrible for him. He was keeping on taking antibiotic and seeing different doctors. Finally, it was Dr. Randeep Guleria at All India Institute of Medical Sciences who thought that this, he has some immune defect, and he diagnosed him as common variable immunodeficiency. And he was put on IVIG and he was doing well. What he had done, because of the cost factor, he has stopped taking his IVIG, and he developed this pneumonia. When we resumed, gave him IVIG, within a few days, his pneumonia got better, his fever got better, and he was all right. It's a rare illness. In UK, there are only 2,000 cases all over UK. It's not very common. And you give common variable deficiency, including T cell, B cell deficiency, because we survive on our immunity. We all have infections, and it is our immune system which fights the disease, and we do well. So there is in every disease, especially chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, they are very troublesome illnesses. Bronchiectasis, at times extensive bronchiectasis will cause the stink of the purulent sputum. At times patients will say, knock out my lung. Chronic bronchitis, starts in smokers, atmospheric pollution, it's a crippling illness. To the extent, and they get worried when they develop dyspnea, or shortness of breath. And the extent of shortness of breath at the end is that even if you change site, you desaturate, there are recurrent admissions. So we need to do something about these illnesses. We will be talking about the role of biological response modifiers in respiratory diseases. The talk is about the drug pirepemat, which is an immunomodulator drug, and it helps in these illnesses. So we will be talking about these illnesses. You see, prevention and treatment of acute infection, exacerbations of chronic bronchitis and COPD, bronchiectasis, recurrent respiratory infections, community acquired pneumonia. You see, the decreased ability of the body to fight infections and other diseases. I talked about the primary immune deficiencies are the result of genetic defects, IgA deficiency, B cell immunodeficiency, T cell immunodeficiency, severe combined immune deficiencies. Then there are secondary immune deficiencies result from a variety of factors that can affect the host of an intrinsically normal immune system. These patients have normal immune system, and the infectious agents, drugs, metabolic illnesses, diseases, environmental conditions. One of the major causes of infections in adults is chronic infections like HIV, cancers of immune system. What happens in immune alterations in respiratory illnesses? Most important is chronic COPD and chronic bronchitis. To define it, COPD is a heterogeneous lung condition characterized by chronic respiratory symptoms of dyspnea, cough, sputum production, exacerbations due to abnormalities of airway, that is bronchitis, bronchiolitis, and or alveolitis, that is emphysema, that cause persistent, often progressive airflow obstruction. Chronic bronchitis, as we all know, is defined by the presence of cough and sputum production for at least 3 months per year for 2 consecutive years in the absence of any other conditions that can explain these symptoms. Prevalence of chronic bronchitis is 27 to 35% in COPD patients. You see, we all know that these COPD patients will start initially, will start smoking, and then they will start having some cough, early morning cough, some sputum production. They will keep on, I take a cigarette, I am able to clear my throat, and it continues. They start getting worried, either they are hospitalized or they start developing shortness of breath. When they are not able to walk with their colleagues, that is a bothering symptom. What are the triggers? Triggers for chronic bronchitis, COPD are smoking, indoor and outdoor pollution, non-smoking causes. 70 to 80% of acute exacerbations of COPD are due to respiratory infections. Increased production of pro-inflammatory mediators, compromised innate and adaptive immunity, there is T-cell dysfunction, impaired Th1 and Th2 balance. Patients with COPD had weaker Th2 mediated responses and stronger Th1 cell responses. Th1 is cell mediated and Th2 is B-cell mediated. Respiratory COPD and chronic bronchitis, respiratory tract infections remain the commonest identifiable causes of death for patients with COPD. The presence of bacteria in the airways can amplify airway mucosal inflammation. Infections become increasingly common with disease progression and may contribute to the underlying inflammatory process. The vicious circle of infection, inflammation, injury, and subsequent infection. You see, what are the treatment strategies in patients with chronic bronchitis and the role of biological response modifiers? What can you do about the treatment? You see, you can ask the patient to stop smoking, you can add bronchodilators in the form of beta-2 agonists, anticholinergics, you can give them theophylline. When they are breathless or not maintaining oxygen, their oxygen levels go below 90, you can give oxygen therapy. In acute exacerbations, you can give corticosteroids, antibiotics as and when there is an infection. preventive therapies in the form of immunization for pneumonia or influenza. When patients are very breathless, we can use pulmonary rehabilitation. If they go into respiratory failure, we can use mechanical ventilation. And mucolytics have very little role. What are the role of biological response modifiers? COPD exacerbations are triggered most often by respiratory viral infections, mainly rhinoviruses, even if bacterial component is present. Respiratory tract infection remains the commonest identifiable primary cause of death of our patients with COPD. Presence of bacteria in the airways can amplify airway mucosal inflammation. It is fundamental to act on immune system in order to prevent infections and to reach the optimum care. Due to its role in potentiating and regulating both the innate and acquired immune system, this drug pilidomide appears to be a promising solution. The talk is about all this. I don't have a personal experience with this drug. What happens in bronchiectasis? There is chronic, this is a chronic condition affecting airways. Bronchial tubes are thickened and permanently damaged. There is destruction of elastic and muscular structures. We can see this is normal bronchus and the bronchus full of secretions. Pseudomonas aeruginosa is one of the main culprit. What do these role of biological response modifier in bronchiectasis? Patients with bronchiectasis have their airways colonized by bacteria which activate the immune response with consequent inflammation. Deficiency of the host immune response to bacterial infection is regarded as a primary requirement for development of bronchiectasis. Hypogammaglobulinemia has an important role in the development of bronchiectasis. The stimulation of innate and adaptive immune response by immunomodulators could help in combating the deteriorating health in bronchiectasis patients. You see, if you diagnose a case of common variable deficiency early and don't let the bronchiectasis happen, you can really help these patients greatly. Then there are recurrent respiratory tract infections. Diagnostic criteria, the definition as per Indian consensus, recurrent respiratory infection should be considered in patients with 3 or more episodes of respiratory infection or more than 15 days of respiratory symptoms in the past 3 months. In the clinical practice, most of the recurrent respiratory patients, infectious patients, suffer from recurrent infections of the upper airways, but in approximately 10 to 30%, the lower tract is also affected. Recurrent respiratory infections initially occur in as a viral respiratory tract infection, but bacterial growth is demonstrated in 60% of patients with symptoms of an upper respiratory tract infection of at least 10 days duration. It is very common that patients of bronchiectasis, chronic bronchitis, as and when they will get some viral infection in the form of cold or rhinitis, invariably in next few days the infection travels down whatever you do and it gets infected, they start coughing out purulent sputum, become toxic. At times if they are very less lung, they can go into respiratory failure and may need hospitalization. You see, impact of recurrent respiratory infections on health, immaturity and immune response. Further immunological alterations in infections such as pneumonia can lead to more severe disease. You see, these are the antibiotics which they have mentioned, but in short I would like to say in community acquired infection, routine infection, amoxiclave is a good drug, but if patient have a structural lung disease, then the bugs are like Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, and they need to be covered, and atypical bugs need to be covered by using azithromycin, clarithromycin, or doxycycline. In case of respiratory patients going into respiratory failure, these patients need to be hospitalized and they need to be treated with the gram-negative bugs or as per the culture and sensitivity report of the sputum. When we talk of the antibiotic resistance, it is very important to give antibiotics as per sensitivity or as per the guidelines to avoid resistance, because antibiotic resistance results in mortality. You see, all age rate of deaths attributable to and associated with bacterial antimicrobial resistance.
highest number of deaths were attributed to antimicrobial resistance in patients with lower respiratory infections than all related infections in the thorax. Regarding community acquired pneumonia occurs in community, the bugs are different. Unless patients have a structural lung disease, these patients can have gram-negative bugs also. Otherwise, gram-positive and atypical bugs or certain viruses are responsible for community-acquired pneumonia. Community-acquired pneumonia is the leading cause of mortality and morbidity with substantial clinical and economic impact. India accounts for the 23% of global pneumonia burden and cause fatality rates between 14-30%. And Streptococcus pneumoniae is considered as a major bacterial etiology besides atypical bugs. Increased production of TNF-alpha in CAP patients will increase expression of CD80 and CD86 on dendritic cells. What about the biological response modifiers? We are talking about this. An uncontrolled inflammatory reaction and inadequate immune response contribute to worse outcome in patients with CAP. In community-acquired pneumonia patients, the production of anti-inflammatory cytokines is reduced. Additionally, the capacity of blood leukocytes to release pro-inflammatory cytokines in response to bacteria is also reduced. This results in immune suppression and is associated with secondary infection that increases mortality and in CAP patients. CAP patients have both immune suppression and hyperinflammation, which needs treatment with immunomodulator, which has proven to be useful in improving symptoms. See, this chart is if they are immunomodulators, they can be immunosuppressants and they will be useful in autoimmune illnesses or immunoadjuvants. They help in improving the immune response. And regarding immunostimulators, they improve the immunity and the patients improve. This drug, Gedatimod, it is a synthetic dipeptide with immunomodulatory properties on both innate and adaptive immune responses. In the gastrointestinal tract, it is rapidly absorbed. It has an oral bioavailability of 43-45%. This drug should be given before meals. If you give it with the meals, the efficacy goes down by 45-50%. And hepatic metabolism is minimal. It is excreted unchanged by kidneys. This is the mechanism of action. These are the product details. You see, there are different trials which have shown that if you give this drug in COPD bronchiectasis patients, the response is faster, the virulence becomes better, the fever settles fast, the toxemia gets better. These are the different trials. I go to the summary. Immunological alterations in respiratory disease versus disease outcomes. The lung specific and systemic immune dysfunction facilitates disease exacerbations, thus it needs to be combated with the help of immunomodulators. Respiratory tract infection increases the risk of death in COPD due to worsening of disease and infectious exacerbations. Immature immune response is one of the positive factors for recurrent respiratory infections. Also worsens the outcome of obstructive airway disease. Gedatimod enhances both innate and adaptive immune responses. It affects T lymphocytes, balancing a possible addition and anti-allergic activity. It reduces the severity of infectious episodes. There is rapid recovery, reduces the need for antibiotic and other symptomatic treatments, improves lung function and airway epithelial care. The message is that as and when you see these illnesses like chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, community acquired pneumonia, usually as and when the immune system goes down, the patients are attacked by these bugs and it can even result in mortality. if we have these immunomodulator drugs, we can really help these patients. We have seen that when the immunodeficiency is marked in the form of that zero production of immunoglobulins, and by giving them, the patients can really lead a normal life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mangal sir. Sir, please talk his role in various respiratory conditions. I would request some people like Dr. Anil Gupta sir, they don't have dinner, they don't have anything and then anybody. But they have questions. So I would request Dr. Anil Gupta sir to ask questions. One of the most erudite, learned persons in the forum, and he comes only with one agenda, that is of learning and giving some information to, you know, what should I call, the lesser mortals like us.
Sir, can we use immunosuppressant in IPF also?
Sir, why? You are asking invasive pulmonary aspergillosis.
Immunosuppressant IPA patients,
we have the 9 days,
not
4 days.
Can we use that?
So, actually, the treatment for those patients still not standardized, but it is suggested that if you are making a diagnosis of IPAP, it's always better to give at least 3 to 6 month trial of immunosuppressives instead of antibiotics. Because there is some evidence that it is may have autoimmune pathogenesis. So we need to suppress that first, then only we can consider antibiotics.
I know one patient who presented to a rheumatologist 6 years back with the skin thickening and some changes in the nail. And he did some tests, you said something like calcometry, etc. He diagnosed scleroderma, and he was started, I think, Cellcept, maybe some other medicine, I don't remember. Then at present, he is having lung fibrosis. Today also, he was seen by that rheumatologist, and it is moderately severe pulmonary fibrosis. He is on Cellcept, tadalafil, plus anti-fibrotic like plus some other medicines. So what is the prognosis in this type of patient? 6 minute walk test was better today than done around 4 months back. And anti-proBNP is 613 today.
So as such, if any patient, if any connective tissue disease, if they develop ILD, ILD itself carries a worse prognosis, independent of other diseases. So there are studies which have shown ILD itself is an independent risk factor for death. Many patients die because of respiratory failure. Instead of, we usually say, I read at least during my MD course that patients who are having connective tissue disease, they don't die because of connective tissue disease. They will die of cardiovascular events. But once patient develop ILD, the death, usually cause of death is ILD, no other thing. So, the first thing. Second thing is, regarding prognosis, is very erratic. Nobody can predict in CTD ILDs. There are patients who will be so rapidly progressing. There will be patients who will keep on endulating once you start treatment, they will stabilize, stop again, go up. And there will be patients who will be very rapidly progressing. So, it is very, very difficult to say whether this particular patient, how is going to behave. But it's very, very irritating. That's why there is no standard guideline for treatment for these patients. That's why they are asking to classify these patients in these groups. The possible reversibility, potential to progress, potential to reverse, and
he is also having pulmonary hypertension. I think tadalafil naturally is taking for that. So, is it a worse prognostic factor? Pulmonary hypertension.
Yeah, and any patient who has developed PH, the chances of mortality in next few years is very high.
Sir, wonderful presentation on ILD rheumatoid arthritis.
Yes sir. I will come to everyone. Everyone is welcome to ask a question, and I am also allowed to ask a question. Sir, wonderful presentation.
I just wanted to know, we have a lot of cases of rheumatoid arthritis and scleroderma and self-presented cases also, and you had a wonderful presentation. I wanted to ask you, what is the ideal time to screen these patients for lung involvement? A case of rheumatoid arthritis who has only joint involvement, classical involvement, NTCCP positive, RA factor positive, when should I, because the patient is asymptomatic, and you said, and I was told by Mr. Rajaram, ladies and gentlemen, please understand, this is a pilot project. What they will learn from here, the Cipla people, they will take it to the entire nation. This is their first CME with physicians. I told them, you involve us in your program and then take it to the entire nation. And this is a pilot project. What we give them today, they will take this learning to their HO and tell them, involve physicians in the program of interstitial lung disease and connective tissue disorders. Every rheumatoid, every scleroderma should be a potential lung involvement. Sir, my humble question to you is, when should we start suspecting or when should we start screening these guys for a lung involvement?
So, first, thanks for the compliment. Second thing is, I think this is very most important question. So, I told that these patients require close follow-up. Two investigations I said. One is pulmonary function testing, another is HRCT. So in every patient, we should take history. If they are having any respiratory symptoms in the form of dry cough or shortness of breath. And the second most important is pulmonary function testing, volumes and DLCO. And this can be done every 3 to 6 months. HRCT, I will say there is no need because asymptomatic preserved pulmonary function, chances of significant ILD will be very, very low. So if somebody is having any symptoms or impairment of this on spirometry, then those patients should undergo HRCT also. So and at the beginning itself.
Just a minute, you mentioned about the 6-minute test walk. And I know Dr. Mangla sir is a great fan of 6-minute test walk. And he not only finds out respiratory cases, he also finds out about coronary artery disease with the 6-minute test walk. He diagnosed my brother, my real brother, with 6-minute test walk. And I could submit him for angiography and could save his life. What about the 6-minute test walk?
So, I think that is also important issue because many patients who are coming to us, they may be having advanced ILD. So, they may not be fit for spirometry. With repeated attempts, they are unable to blow adequately or they are already on oxygen. There may be multiple reasons. So in those cases, 6-minute walk test is very useful. And there is consistent data which has shown that it can predict the prognosis. So 6-minute walk test in those patients, especially those who are unable to perform spirometry, can be very, very useful.
Sir, in every case, my very challenging question, and maybe you find it very, you said idiopathic, idiot, and pathetic. Maybe you find the question very pathetic. In every case of connective tissue disorder, RA, scleroderma, should we not have a baseline HRCT and a PFT? Is it not mandatory?
So, none of the guidelines currently recommend that, and we don't know how this rate will be. But spirometry definitely, because non-invasive, it can be done easily without much risk. Because HRCT, somebody can see that why to expose to so much of radiation. That is the only thing. Otherwise, I don't see anything it should not be done. But currently, no recommendation says this. No guideline says this.
Sir, forget about the
HRCT is required. And in my practice, I don't do
it. You don't do it?
No.
Alright. Dr. Karin Podar ma'am had raised her hand. I'm sure she must be having a very good question.
Hello sir, nice talk. I heard Sadhguru says excess traveling by air may be the cause of interstitial lung disease. What do you say, sir? I have seen few patients also. Few patients, few people in my family. They travel a lot and they travel maybe coincidence.
So, thank you for asking question, but I think only plausible mechanism if I see, maybe something in AC. Because AC is one risk factor which can lead to hypertension pneumonitis. Air travel as such, I don't find any case, or at least I am not aware that air travel can lead to ILD. Pneumothorax, yes. Pulmonary embolism, yes. But not ILD.
Sir, Dr. Amitabh Gupta, an eminent neurosurgeon from PSRI Hospital. Eminent neurosurgeon.
Thanks a lot. I learned a lot from you, Dr. Amitabh. What I would like to know the other part. I think you mentioned the other effects of RA, which is bronchiectasis. So my question is totally different from ILD. So what is the, first of all, percentage of bronchiectasis, and then in a diagnosed case of RA, a bronchiectasis, how much the significance you will put that this is going to be progressive, or how the disease is working, or what is the kind of treatment you would be giving? And looking at the 6-minute walk as Dr. Mangla is talking about, I think it is normal for the patient. So it is absolutely normal. So the lung function tests are supposedly showing the normal as per the average for the age and for the 6-minute walk. But still, she has bronchiectasis, she has basal infiltrates, and she shows in the scan in the HRCT that the bronchioles are directed in the basal area. So where do we go from here? Is it progressive, is it stagnant, or we treat as per the symptom?
So if I understand correctly, you are asking about rheumatoid arthritis-associated bronchiectasis. First thing is how common it is. So I showed the figures also, it's not very common, but it's not uncommon also. If you are seeing maybe 100%, 1 or 2%, probably 1 to 2% only. Majority of patients will have ILD changes. Some will have small ILD, bronchiolitis. Then few will have bronchiectasis. If you see vice versa, the patient who are having bronchiectasis, and if you evaluate for etiology, then rheumatoid maybe 5 to 10% of those bronchiectasis will have because of rheumatoid arthritis. The second thing, there is no specific treatment for bronchiectasis related to rheumatoid or something else. Only specific treatment for bronchiectasis is for this immune deficiency. IgG related deficiency is there, then only replacement. Otherwise, all bronchiectasis, irrespective of etiology, treatment is general. You need to improve the airway hygiene, you need to improve the cough, you need to immunize, maybe some bronchodilator, only if there is a bronchial obstruction or obstructive physiology on spirometry. Otherwise, not.
So, Percy, there is no change in the treatment of the RA. So, if the RA is stable, so you don't do anything.
No.
Right. Dr. Sanjeev Bang has a question.
There's a small question. You talked about smoking. Is passive smoking as important as active smoking?
Yeah, very great question, and probably nobody will be able to answer this unless someone sees it systematically. But if we correlate with other diseases, for example COPD or cancer, there is some data coming which is implicating the passive smoking or household smoking or the indoor smoke are also implicated on these diseases also. So probably, because smoke, I told the mechanism, it leads to stimulation. So if smoking because of you smoking or somebody else is smoking is goes inside, definitely it can lead to that.
Dr. H.P. Singh sir has a question.
Thank you, sir. Sir, my question to Dr. Mangla, please. Sir, you have talked about the community union.
Community
pneumonia. Yes. There's another pneumonia nowadays called white lung pneumonia. White lung pneumonia is specific children. The both the pneumonia are similar. Both are similar. The prognosis of your lung pneumonia is very not, but this white lung pneumonia's progress very good. What are you saying about this?
Any pneumonia, you see, the alveoli filling with the inflammatory exudate, we call whiteness. It depends whether the whiteness is going to both the lungs and causing ARDS. In that case, the prognosis is depending upon the etiology is bad. Otherwise, as such, community acquired pneumonia with the immunocompetent people, they usually do well unless they require hospitalization. Those who require ICU care, they have an associated mortality. Those patients who are managed in the wards or in the OPD or in the community, they do usually well, unless they have some immunocompromised state.
So, white lung pneumonia is safe, 100%
safe? No, no, no question. I am saying that if the white lung pneumonia, the alveoli are filled with inflammatory exudate. If it is extensive, involving both the lungs, then it's a serious illness. If it is a community acquired pneumonia, that will also cause whiteness of the lungs because of the inflammatory exudate.
In alveolar pneumonia, process started the same. Slow.
It depends, you know. Some patients' immune status is there, they suddenly become very sick. Some patients progress very fast, may go on to the ARDS involving both the lungs. The process is different.
Sir, you had a question, sir. Dr. Haddad, please.
Yes, sir.
There are excellent talk you gave, very informative. There are some very small queries. In the initial stages, could a miliary tuberculosis skagram mimic an ILD skagram?
Definitely. Actually, because, see, CT scan or maybe radiograph or chest X-ray, we want to see the patterns. So if we classical X-ray, we see miliary tuberculosis, it's probably nodules. So it can be confused with nodular pattern of ILDs or DPLDs. That can be confused. That's why I am telling we need to rule out mimics. So if somebody is saying a nodular lesion, it can be vasculitis, it can be MADS, it can be mononucleosis, it can be histoplasmosis, or similar more fungi also which can create like this. In our scenario, probably miliary tuberculosis, 1 to 10 ILD tuberculosis, then maybe large or other things like this.
Dr. Vijay Hada. So, wonderful insights on pulmonary fibrosis. Just a word on two antifibrotics which have been approved by the US FDA. I'm referring to the bupivacaine and the nitazoxanide. So, neither drugs are curative. See, they could just arrest the, or slow down the progression of the fibrosis. Are there some newer drugs? I'm talking about the sericatinib and also the other drug, which is the Bristol Script Mayer drug, which has recently probably got an approval, not fully approval, but probably an orphan drug approval. Just talk us through these two newer drugs.
Sir, first thing, I think that any drug which is currently available for treatment of pulmonary fibrosis, at the best, I'm stretching it, they will be moderate efficacy. Moderate means you cannot neglect, but you can also cannot fully support that they are going to make any dramatic response.
So you cannot cure it, probably slow the progression.
Yes. Yes.
Right. So are there drugs which could probably, you know, not only slow the progression, probably reverse?
I don't think there is any drug till now which can do that. But
I'm talking about the sericatinib.
Any nib. There is no one which
and
has
the Bristol Script Mayer drug, which probably, you know, says that probably you could reverse to some extent this fibrosis. Talk us through these two drugs.
Sir, even if any drug, they are not beyond
the Script Mayer drug. So probably, you know, what can I say? Not only reduces PPF, that is the progressive pulmonary fibrosis, also in IPD. This is an LPA1 antagonist. So these drugs are new drugs. Let's talk us through this probably.
Sir, I think I did not read recently, but which I can recollect is they are also not curative. they are also doing almost same, and with previous experiences, even the generating of propranolol, small studies were shown very, very huge effect.
Those are
but once they have
old drugs, old drugs. The recent drugs I'm talking about, the sertralinib, and of course the the recent BMS, the Bristol Myers Squibb drug, which probably say not only not only regresses the fibrosis, it helps in a lot of way because it reduces the fibrinogen response.
Let us hope, sir.
Thank you, sir.
You need to wait, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah,
sure.
Sir, after very exhaustive questions from my friend Dr. Prince, sir, many of my questions have been stolen. One by Dr. Arvinda Singh, like pulmonary tuberculosis, biliary tuberculosis mimicking ILD. Sir, in COVID, many of our patients were found to be having ILD. Was COVID a cause of it or precipitating cause?
In many cases, we will be able to tell this is COVID-related. But in few patients, where we came across the same problem, they were having ILDs. Probably one thing can help if we know the pattern. Because till now, the most common pattern which is seen in COVID is NSFB pattern, which is subpleural sparing, some GGOs, that kind of. And along with that, if COVID is there, then probably we can. But in many cases where there is no history of COVID and we are unable to find any cause, in those cases very going to be very bit tough. And there is no way you can tell whether it is idiopathic or it is related to COVID.
I will limit my questions to only two or three. One of them is about recent our laborers enclosed in a tunnel. So was it a cause for any pulmonary problem, and we'll think it may lead to enhancement of pulmonary fibrosis?
Sir, if there is some exposure to maybe fungus, maybe that kind of thing.
They were exposed to many things in 17 days.
So their chances they can develop some kind of pulmonary toxicity, maybe chemical pneumonitis, maybe hypertension pneumonitis, that kind of thing. They can definitely be at risk.
I find some people feeding pigeons in the open, and some feeding pigeons in their home. So do you find how much is the difference between some occasional feeding the pigeons or keeping the pigeon at home?
I think it's whenever there is exposure, most of the time the intensity and duration, both are important. In only few cases, probably small exposure is good enough to initiate a reaction. But otherwise, intensity as well as duration. So more exposure, more intensity, there are more chances of development of lung feature or maybe hypertension pneumonitis. So those who are keeping it a pet at home, they are continuously exposed. So there are more chances of development.
Sir, my last comment about air travel, as Dr. Mrs. Bagar had asked about, it's a closed space travel. So is it more towards commonly acquired pneumonia or towards any other thing?
So if somebody is carrying some infection, the chances that they can catch up. So otherwise, I don't know if you are asking for something else. Thank you very much, sir.
Dr. Sir, you mentioned about the routine vaccinations of flu and pneumonia. Sir,
with
such sick cases,
is it
advisable to give them COVID vaccination also?
I think currently COVID we can forego, because currently COVID is mobile, so we can avoid that. Other two, probably no use to them at this point of time.
Okay, now regarding the pneumonia vaccination, which one do you propagate? You know, the pneumovax 23 or the conjugate vaccine?
So, see if we, there are two, three which are there. PCD 13, PCD 15, and PCD 20. So what we do is either you use the CDC ribbon, this PCD 15 and this PPV 23. But I think 15 is not available in India. So PCV 13 and PPV 23 is available with us. So if you want to give both, then first you give 13 and followed by maybe 2-3 weeks or 2-3 months, you can give PPV 23.
Friends, I think all of you would agree that we had two wonderful presentations today. One by Dr. Vijay Hadda and another by Dr. K.K. Mangla sir. We did many questions on Dr. Vijay Hadda's presentation. The other one was presentation on the product called Maximu. I would like to ask just one question to sir, Dr. K.K. Mangla. Sir, what is your personal experience of using Maximu?
This drug I have not used. I have no personal experience with this.
Sir, what is the potential and what is the potential benefit of this drug?
By improving the immunity, by adaptive and innate immunity both, by improving the immunity, I think it definitely helps the patients of chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, community acquired pneumonia. By enhancing immune system, I think